Just a few words about Frank Sesno. Frank is a former CNN anchor. He was a White House correspondent, and he was the Washington bureau chief. All really important and significant jobs. But more importantly, he is now the director of the School of Media and Public Affairs at the George Washington University, a great institution, I might add, having graduated from there. And any institution that graduates me has got to be really good. Frank has interviewed dozens of world leaders, literally dozens, including the U.S. presidents, and is the creator of Planet Forward, which is an innovative forum seeking solutions to some of the world's toughest challenges. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce Frank Sesno. The way we're going to run this is Frank is going to talk a little bit about his new book, Ask More. And then once he's done with that, he has agreed to take some questions, both in the room and online. We are streaming this to all of the locations at Noblis, and you can get on WebEx and chat and send a question, and I will ask Frank the questions. So with that, Frank, welcome.
Thank you very much. It's absolutely delightful to be here again. I haven't been to this building, but I've been to Noblis many times, and Liddy and I go way back, and Amr and I go back, and I really, really am gratified to be here. Now, that's a brilliant building, except for the column that's here that's getting in the way of my looking to people over here. So if you want to move over so we can make eye contact throughout, you can do that, or I'll do this so that I can make eye contact. When it comes to Q&A, the first one's coming from somewhere over there, so just so you know. It's a very interesting experience. This is my first book, but I've been on television all my life, or not all my life, but nearly, all my working life, radio before that. And, but there's something different and challenging, and maybe a little bit more enduring than what you do and get and how you communicate with broadcast. And what I'm discovering is something that I hadn't anticipated with this book, because none of us could have anticipated the moment we are in. And that is suddenly this sense that the idea of asking and listening and learning and connecting seems more relevant than it's been, because we are looking around wondering how that's going to work. So I want to talk about a few things. I want to talk about the book. I want to talk about the larger context. I also want to talk about the construct of questions and then open it up to yours. And I would invite, you know, the snarkiest or toughest or most demanding question that you can muster. Where did this come from? So all my life, I have done something that I positively adore, which is to interview people, because I find people amazing. Every single person in this room, every single person on the planet has a story all their own. They have confronted adversity and challenge and tragedy and triumph. They have learned. They have succeeded and they have failed. They are trying to do something in their lives, whether it's with their kids or their spouse or their work or their invention. Maybe they believe passionately in something. And when you interview somebody, you try to connect with at least some of those dots, depending on who your audience is. So if you're on public radio or on CNN, that's one thing. But if you're a therapist, you're interviewing people, and you're connecting for something different. If you're a boss and you're doing a job interview, you're doing something different. So as I started thinking about this, I realized that my questions in all these different interviews I do, and I'll move around so I can see these people on the other side of the column. You're still there? We're okay so far. I realized that the questions that I pose, the way I approach them, the way I research them, and the things I'm listening for are different depending on the kinds of people I'm talking to in the interviews that I'm engaging. If I'm interviewing a politician, God forbid, my purpose is different than if I'm interviewing a Nobel Prize-winning physicist. Because with a politician, I'm trying to force him or her to explain what they stand for, what they've done, hold them to account for those words or deeds or actions. If I'm interviewing the physicist, I want that person to explain what it feels like to be a winner. what their invention has changed. It's not most likely going to be a confrontational discussion as it would be with someone else. If I'm interviewing somebody who, God forbid, has just experienced tragedy and is speaking and sharing about it, I'm connecting with that person entirely differently, empathetically, to draw them out. So what I did with the book is I thought, okay, what are these categories of questioning? And I ended up with 11 of them. And what I would argue, and I think, I hope, it can guide all of our lives as we think about it, is that the way we approach these conversations are different based on what we're trying to do. What is our outcome? What do we want from the conversation? Do I want to connect with you empathetically because I want to know, why are you wearing a red sweater and where did that come from and what is the spirit that moves you? Or am I trying to talk to you about how are you running this business and what are your projections for 2 years from now and why do you make those projections? That's a very different kind of conversation. There are some things that I think cut across, things that are shared. Preparation, what I call making the appointment, is something that is constant. So if you think about it, if I'm doing an interview with Amr and Amr's coming to the studio at 10 o'clock, Amr knows he's going to be at the studio at 10 o'clock and I'm going to engage him and talk to him. He's ready to sit down and do that. If I'm going to my therapist at 10 o'clock, I've made an appointment and I'm going to my therapist. I'm expecting to be asked those questions. I'm ready to do that. And if you think about the chance encounters that you have with someone versus those where you have the appointment, they're very different outcomes. And so I might say to my father, I have a 91-year-old father who's going through some tough times now because his wife recently had a stroke and he's dealing with things that he doesn't want to deal with. And he's in denial about a lot of different things. And if I just pop a question at him about something that's difficult or unpleasant, he may shut down. If I say to him, hey, Dad, how about if we have a chat tomorrow at 10 and let's talk about power of attorney? He'll say, well, 10 o'clock isn't good. And I'll say, well, how about 11? He'll say, but he's expecting that conversation. He's expecting me to ask him those questions. So making that appointment. How many of you have heard of StoryCorps on public radio or whatever? So StoryCorps is this incredible thing where two people sit down and speak to one another. And David Isay, who's the creator of StoryCorps, talks about the power of making that appointment, of the microphone in between, so we expect that. The next thing, and one of the things that is also similar as a theme throughout, is preparation. We prepare differently based on these categories of questions, but to be prepared to go into something, into this exchange, is very important. If you're sitting down with a client, knowing where that client comes from, what that client's challenges are, what kind of business the client has done with you in the past, what the client is trying to do longer term, is vital to having the conversation and asking the right questions of that client. So preparation. One of my favorites is listening. Right? You can't be a good questioner and then really get something out of it if you're not a good listener. And the best interviewers in all walks of life are the best listeners. And one of the things I write about here is, what kind of listener are you? Have you even ever asked yourself that question before? I hadn't until I started talking to people for the book. And I said, well, what do you mean by that? Well, she said, are you an interrupter? Do you listen for stories and personal anecdote, or do you listen for fact and detail and data? We listen differently. And knowing how we listen helps us calibrate how we're going to listen so that we can engage someone really well. I did a class, and I'll talk about this in a minute, where did this book come from? I did a class a few years ago, which is really what launched me on this, called The Art of the Interview. And my students all had, and I'm about to teach it again, which is, it's a lot of fun. And my students all had to do different things, including various assignments, one of which was an oral history. Their final project was an oral history. And I encouraged them to talk to a relative, a father, a mother, a grandma, to do an oral history. And if you put something like that on, if you record that, that is a gift forever to the family, as long as you don't lose it and the technology becomes obsolete, right? But imagine if you could listen to your great-great-grandmother, what life was like when great-great-grandma lived, the stories you would get and how wonderful that would be. Well, guess what? Every single one of my students who interviewed a parent or a grandparent, every single one of them learned something profound that they never knew before from someone they'd lived with all their lives. How many of you have kids? Okay. How many of your kids have ever sat you down and for 30 minutes just asked you about your life? Not many. They're into their lives, and we care about them, and that's the way it goes. But where did you come from, and what happened to you when you were young, and what was your trauma that you overcame, and all of that didn't happen. But these students who did it, and that's when I realized that they're one of the ways I realized there was something here, because all they did was ask. And there's an exercise. I have some little exercises throughout. And one of the exercises I suggest to people is sit with someone for 20 minutes or for 30 minutes and ask them questions. There are two things you may not do. Well, two things you may not do. One, you can't talk about yourself. And there are two words you may not use, I and me. There's something I refer to as the I syndrome, and we all know it, right? We've all heard it. We all have friends and family and others who fall into that trap. Oh my gosh, I was driving the other day and I got into a terrible accident and I totaled the car and, you know, the passenger was hurt and, you know, I don't know how, it's just, it was very traumatic. You know, that happened to me just the other day. I was driving and it's like, are you kidding me? Really? All you do is talk about yourself? So if you purge the words I and me for 20 minutes while you're engaging another person, it's unbelievable what you will discover, and that's what the students discovered from people they lived with all their lives. Two executives I hung around that helped me write this book, or inspired me for this book over time. One was Jack Welch, former CEO of GE. And if you've read Jack's books, or if you've ever spent any time or watched him, he is unbelievable like this. Hi, ma'am, so nice to meet you. What's your name?
Jane.
Jane? Hi, where are you from? It's classified, you can't tell me. Many places, okay, it's wait. We could start, but I won't do that. But, you know, so Jack Welch will engage somebody and he'll question them. And he would take 27-year-olds out to lunch and others, young people in the company, once a week. What were they trying to do? Where were their interests? What were their consumption habits? And he was just insatiably curious. And I had an opportunity to do some events with Jack Welch and I watched him work a room and it was fascinating. All right, park that. I had an experience with another executive with whom I worked. And he was new when he came to the company that I was at the time. And I led him around for a period of time. And I watched him over a day and a half never ask a single, I was aware of this, he never asked a single person a single question. He was very assertive. He was very sure of himself. He was going to, you know, it was going to be great. Very creative, very thoughtful, very smart guy. I don't know what possessed me to say this, but at the end of our time together, I was sitting with him and I said, you are either going to succeed completely or you are going to fail spectacularly, because I felt there was no gray area. And how is it that someone could come in and be so sure and so assertive and not need to ask anybody anything as he's just starting up a job? He succeeded for a time and then he failed. Right. So the idea of this book, of how could we use questions as tools, how could we use them in different ways is really what inspired me. So my first chapter is about diagnostic questions, what I call the ground floor of questioning. What's gone wrong here? How do we figure out what's gone wrong? And we can't fix something, we can't respond to it unless we have a good diagnosis. And each of my chapters, I wrap around characters, really interesting people, either I knew or I discovered or whatever, some famous, some not. And in that first chapter, it's a nurse practitioner in Appalachia, and a Wall Street turnaround guy, and my neighbor, the roofer. And they all do the same thing really well. They go in, what's the problem? What are the symptoms? How do we know? How long have they been there? What have you tried in the past? What worked? What didn't work? If you have a leak in the roof, I hope you don't in this new building, but if you have a leak in the roof, it may come from right above that leak, or it could be 40 feet away across the roof, because that's how water travels. And so what you see is not necessarily what's gone wrong. Same thing with a patient that my nurse practitioner friend talked about, who came in with having a health crisis, and what she discovered as the cause was something that was very surprising that this person didn't want to talk about, and it was a series of questions. that got her there. What do these people all share, and what's the lesson I think we take from it? If you want to diagnose a problem, you need to go looking for bad news. Now, there's a concept. Open your mind and understand that our challenge, the outcome here, is to figure out, to diagnose what's gone wrong, which means we need to ask the questions to get us there. My next chapter is a chapter on strategic questions. Once you figure out what's wrong, you can figure out what your goals 3, 4, 6 months from now. And my character for this chapter is General Colin Powell, a man whom I respect a great deal, and I spent the day with him. I covered him first when I was a White House correspondent. I was the kindergarten correspondent at the Reagan White House, and he was Deputy National Security Advisor at the time. And then I followed him throughout his career and covered him a great deal. Strategic questions are the long-range questions. They look over the horizon. We're thinking 6 months, a year, 3 years from now. Where do you want this company to go? What are your big risks? What are your big opportunities? What are your aspirations? What's the cost-benefit analysis of all of that? And I spent the time with Powell because I thought he really captured success and failure. First Gulf War, where he posed 8 strategic questions to the President of the United States. And he said, if we can say yes to each of these questions, I commend action. And we should do that. And the answers were, in fact, all in the affirmative. Second Gulf War, those questions were not asked in that way. There was a completely different mindset, a completely different approach. And one could argue one certainly can observe a very different outcome. Gulf War I was 100 hours of ground combat. And a clear, one of the questions is, do we know what success is? What is the end state in military terms? And asking that question and being able to answer that question definitively is vital. So what I try to do in this book is engage these different places. And going into these questions, going into a situation knowing what we want to get out is critical to then putting that strategy, that question strategy, and the listening strategy together. One of my favorite types of questions and one of the chapters that I have is what I call empathetic questions. Anybody ever listen to Terry Gross, Fresh Air on the radio? A few of you, okay. So Terry Gross is a master at this, and she likes to interview artists and creative people, and then she goes for what she calls the essence of what that person is, what makes them creative, what makes them artistic. And what she is asking about is your origins, your inspirations, those experiences that you had perhaps as a younger person that inspired fear or awe or your creativity. But along the way, and probably one of her greatest gifts, is her listening. And one of the interviews I captured, which she described as one of her most powerful, was with Maurice Sendak, for those of you in the room, right? Where the Wild Things Are, we all read them to our kids. And she interviewed Maurice Sendak shortly before his death, about 18 months, I think that's what it was. Maybe not quite that. And he was very reflective. And Maurice Sendak had come out as gay late in his life. His partner had died not so long ago. His publisher had died not so long ago, and he was feeling very lonely. And he started speaking, and Terry just heard this. And she keyed into it. And she asked him just these very short, specific kind of questions that drew him out, and he started talking about his mortality and how he felt looking out at the old maple trees out the window. And it was poetry, but it was so from the heart. And it shed light on what this man was all about and who he was and where this came from, his essence. In that chapter as well is a wonderful woman named Betty Prestera. Betty Prestera is a woman I heard about. She lives in North Carolina, and she is a family therapist. She's also an award-winning ballroom dancer. She is a character in every sense of the word. And I flew down to North Carolina on a Saturday, and I said, let's meet for you know, in the morning and we'll chat. And she pulled up in her little Honda Civic and she met me there and she bounded out of her car. And before we were out of the airport, she was getting me to talk about things that, it doesn't take much to get me to talk about things, but she was getting me to talk about things deep in my life, my parents and where I came from, and why I was doing this, what I wanted, and she just was engaging me. Well, what she does as a therapist is she draws you out one question at a time, much like Terry Gross. She starts with what we call open-ended questions. And those open-ended questions can be simply, tell me about yourself. What was most important in your life? But then through her listening and through her training, she will go down deeper and be very specific and focused, continuing to draw you out. And it creates an empathetic, very empathetic. She is incredibly empathetic because you just get the sense that she's standing in your shoes, that she gets it through her questioning. One other chapter that I've got focuses on science questions. Now science, how many scientists in the room? Okay, a few of you. Science is really interesting, all right? Remember what I said about diagnostic questions, you go looking for bad news? Well, here's science. Something in the natural world that we want to figure out. How's that work? Why does the sun rise? Whatever it is. What's a nanoparticle? And you pose a quest, you ask a question, and then you craft a hypothesis around that. And then what do scientists do? They measure, they collect data, they do it over time, sometimes a lot of time, to prove their hypothesis wrong so that it might be right. So they might learn that it might be right. They submit that work to peer review so that their peers can take shots at it. Well, imagine that, trying to prove yourself wrong. How many of us do that on a daily basis? So I started by telling you that when I wrote this book, I had no idea that we would be in this moment that we are now. Looking for bad news, knowing what kind of listener you are, trying to prove yourself wrong, building a body of evidence. We are at a time of national decision and national, we made our national decision, of national moment where this process of asking deeply and listening intently is both under siege and more important than it's ever been. I'll veer off for a few minutes and talk about a few other things, and then we'll come back in Q&A to wherever you guys want to go. But there's a lot to be unhappy about in the way our presidential campaign was run in terms of did we ask more and did we listen well. The media, where I come from, spent a lot of time and a lot of real estate covering the campaign. But did they ask the right questions? Did they ask them in the right way? Did we listen, really listen, both as media and as citizens, to the answers? Now we've got a very interesting, challenging moment. And our president-elect has put a lot of things on the table that are really, really profoundly interesting and complicated. Let's take a few of them. Repeal Obamacare. Does NATO matter anymore? Is NATO relevant? If you went out on the streets today and talked to typical people and asked them, what does NATO stand for? What do those letters stand for? What do you think people would say? What percentage of people would know that it stands for the North Atlantic Treaty Organization? And what percentage of people would know why it was formed, when it was formed, what it has done, who its members are, where the money comes? Oh, well, the money comes from, yeah, they're not paying their fair share. But beyond that, if we're going to dismantle or challenge that, shouldn't that process and decision be built on a knowledge base driven by a series of very thorough questions? Well, I don't think the media did a very good job in the campaign getting off of the controversy and off of the noise and on to the complicated issues like that. Obamacare. We're going to repeal Obamacare. Fair enough. Rates have gone up. Maybe it's not working. Some of the exchanges in some of the states may be headed for, you know, oblivion. Fair enough. Who gets hurt? Who gets helped? What happens to the doctors? How will hospitals you know, fill in the blanks. What replaces it? If you replace it, how do you come up with the money that's saved? Did it actually save money and cut the cost, cut the rate of increase of premiums, or did it not? I am not passing judgment on whether Obamacare should be repealed or not. What I'm saying is, when we have big, complicated issues on the table, the media have a responsibility, in my view, to inform and to educate, built on the series of questions, not one, not two, that must be asked, and asked more and repeatedly and in depth. Campaign. The candidates come on. I don't care who the candidate was, whether it was Hillary or Chris Christie or, well, he couldn't make it because the bridge was closed, but when Christie was on, or Donald Trump, every interview with every candidate on every network, in my view, which is clearly a minority view, should contain a place where you get off the politics, off the horse race, off the accusation, and okay, for the next 3 minutes or 5 minutes or 6 minutes, let's talk about and pick an issue. And the person who's asking that series of questions is prepared and trained like a lawyer to know what the facts are, what has been said or not said. It's not to prove a point, it's just to draw you out. Dr. Thomas, you want to abolish oxygen. Let's talk about that, right?
I need every molecule.
Yeah, well, we all do. But I'm quite serious about this. And having done this, I did an interview with George Herbert Walker Bush 2 days before the election in 1992. I did it on Sunday. I got on a plane. I flew out. I was with CNN at the time, and I flew out to La Crosse, Wisconsin. And he was in the middle of a campaign, and he was not doing very well in the polls. There had been a slight blip in the couple of days before we went up for Bush in the in a Wall Street Journal poll and a couple of others. So there was this kind of, well, maybe things are moving. And unfortunately for him, we got our polling number just before I sat down with him, which I sprung to him on the air, which probably wasn't very nice, but which showed the numbers going back down again. But more to the point, the special prosecutor, special investigator, had just indicted the former defense secretary, Caspar Weinberger, relating to the Iran-Contra affair, for those of you who might remember that. And George Herbert Walker Bush had not been asked about that. And in fact, George H.W. Bush tried to keep his distance from this whole Iran-Contra business when it was going on. He really didn't want to answer questions about it. So I asked him, and he didn't answer. And I asked again, and he didn't answer. And I asked again, and he didn't answer. And he said, Frank, are we going to talk about anything else here? He was clearly annoyed. And I said, well, yes, Mr. President, we will. But you're running for President of the United States. There is this new development. It seems to me that the president has an obligation to, you know, answer this question. We managed to get through this thing. He was not a happy camper. He canceled all of his interviews with other media after that, and that was that. But the job of the media is not to be popular, but to create what I call the relationship of a respectful adversary. The adversarial relationship of press and someone in power is what our founders built into our system. Thomas Jefferson did not like the media very much. He did not have a good time with it, but he believed in its centrality to our democracy. How is that relationship going to go forward now? We have very big questions about what is real news and what is fake news and how much news organizations are going for ratings and circulations and clicks and how much they really have a commitment to the public good and the questions that must be asked that go down deeper and that explain more thoroughly. What happens when the President of the United States doesn't like being criticized and goes after news organizations and individual journalists? Do the questions lose legitimacy because of a more contentious environment? What happens to public information in the process? And even more importantly, what happens to our ability to convene the public, regardless of their political stripe or their ideology, to agree on a certain set of core facts that just are, in the sense of science, truth, reality, right? I think we're at a very perilous time. I'm very concerned about this because I think on both sides of the equation, there are some big questions about how we're going to behave, the level of civic discourse, and how we're going to try to ask and whether we will listen. I'll just close with a couple things and then open it up to your questions wherever you'd like to go with this. I hope that if you read the book, and I do hope you will, I hope that you will see how you can incorporate this approach in your own lives with your children or your parents or your friends or certainly in the work environment, with the clients that you're working with. I have a chapter on shared mission here, and it's wrapped around a variety of people who do a variety of things, but some of it is just, some of it is sort of set in the NGO world. Guy I know by the name of Rick Leach, who heads the World Food Program U.S., who is fighting hunger around the planet and believes that hunger is a solvable problem, as he says. And he has four questions that he poses to individuals and companies when he comes in contact with them as he builds his coalition and support. And one of them is, after establishing that people share the mission, what is your role? What can you do? What do you want to do? But in that chapter, I also have a discussion about a couple of overweight guys who started a company that you may have heard of, Ben and Jerry. And they posed questions to one another, and they wondered what they could do and how they could establish a mission, and they built an amazing company. But another one is the Ritz-Carlton. I figured, well, if I'm going to do, you know, a couple of hippies from Vermont, I need to do the higher-end thing, too. So I met this amazing woman from Ritz-Carlton. And Ritz-Carlton imbues its employees with a level of trust and authority that shocked me. Each person has a couple thousand dollars. Anybody who's dealing with a customer has a couple thousand dollars a day that they can discount something or whatever if they need to without asking for permission to create this memorable experience, because what Ritz-Carlton is trying to do, their fundamental mission is customers for life. They want to create an experience, if you go to the Ritz, where you are a customer for life. And they teach their employees to be great questioners. So if I go to concierge, in general, you're now the concierge, and thank you so much for helping me have my great stay here. If I go to the concierge and I say, excuse me, where's the gift shop? The concierge may actually stand up and let me walk you around the corner. And while they're walking around the corner, they'll say, by the way, what brings you to our lovely city? And you'll say, oh, I'm here for the flower show. And they'll say, oh, really? What's your favorite flower? And you'll say, lilacs. Well, you just might find sometime when you stay at the Ritz that lilacs are waiting for you in your room, because they take that information and they use that information to create a memorable experience. They teach people what to ask or what not to ask if a couple comes up and they got a kid and it has not been a good day, right? And they can tell it's not been a good day and somebody's agitated. How do you use questions to figure out how people really are and then listen? I closed the book with a chapter on legacy questions inspired by a rabbi I met who is the spiritual care advisor at Montgomery County Hospice. And he works with people at the end of their lives. And the questions they ask him are amazing. What's going to happen to me? Why is God doing this to me? Why is God making me suffer? What is it like on the other side? What will it be like when I'm in the ground? Imagine getting questions like that. And this man is such an artist with how he responds. But generally, he responds with a question of his own. He doesn't answer. He answers with a question to prompt what he says is his goal, his outcome, which is a conversation. Because most people, many people anyway, at that stage of their lives, just, they need to talk. They need to just kind of go. So I look at questions as a great tool and a great gift. They generate conversation. They inspire innovation. They help us learn. They help us connect with others. They help us confront, because they do that too, a chapter on confrontational questioning that has existed and is part of something. And I hope that as you read this book and think about how you might incorporate some of its, what I hope are its lessons anyway, into your working lives and in your personal lives, you will find it useful. And thank you so much for having me here, and I would be delighted to take your questions.